Hey everyone, a very good morning to all of you. Myself, Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. So let's begin this video for today. But before that, I want to inform you about the crash course of SEBI Grade A that we have launched. So guys, this is the course for 30 days, which you can avail in order to get your concepts regarding SEBI cleared. And if you really want to appear for this year's SEBI Grade A examination, so this is the right time, I think, that you should get yourselves enrolled in this course. Also fill the notification form for SEBI Grade A. So on that note, let's begin with the session. But before that, the important information for you all is that you can download this PDF via the Telegram channel, and the link of our channel is in description below. So the first question that we have is, how many total wetlands are surveyed in the Asian waterbird census? So here the right answer is 7. Now all of these 7 wetlands were located in Delhi or near Delhi. Basically, Delhi NCR is the location where these 7 wetlands are located. Now, this clearly indicates that this is not a very large scale census that was held. Actually, not was held, it is still in the process. The date is January 2nd, 2016. So, it is still in the process. Therefore, the results of this census are only restricted to one of the wetlands out of the total 7 wetlands that were surveyed. I will come to that, but these were the basic informations that you should be aware of before beginning this census. Also, you also need to know this thing that water birds are an important indicator of the health of a wetland. Okay. And if you are covering the current affairs videos of mine daily, then you should be aware of the fact that wetlands play a very important role in the entire environment of the earth. Therefore, in light of the importance of wetlands, water birds are also important. Plus, they themselves play a very important role in the entire biodiversity of any place, or we can say of India. Okay, so on that note, let's delve into the details of this census. So, Asian waterbird census is being carried out from this date. Date is not required by you. Okay, you don't have to memorize it. Locations are these 7 wetlands. So, which were these wetlands? First one is Hastinapur Wildlife Sanctuary, Ghanauri and Surajpur wetlands in Greater Noida, Delhi Zoo and Sanjay Lake, Okhla Bird Sanctuary, Najafgarh Jheel and Yamuna River. So, these are the 7 locations that were assessed in this census. Purpose was to identify the areas which need protection for the water birds, and also at the same time assess the health of these wetlands. Who surveyed these areas, who conducted this census? So Wetlands International South Asia and the Bombay Natural History Society, both of these organizations have conducted this survey, which is a part of International Water Bird Census. Now let's come to the results. So as I told you that this survey is still in the process, therefore the results are only restricted to one of the wetlands, which is Sanjay Lake. Now this Sanjay Lake has witnessed a downgrade in the number of water bird species. Earlier there used to be 17 diversified species of water bird in this lake, which has reduced to 13 now, and out of these 13 only 11 are the resident species of the Sanjay Lake and only 2 are the migratory bird species. So all of these are indicating towards a deterioration in the health of the Sanjay Lake. So this is an alert for the system, for the caretakers to wake up and work for the for conservation of the Sanjay Lake. Now which 2 migratory species were found in this lake? So great Cormorant, which migrates from Southeast Asia, and Eurasian Coot, which migrates from temperate Asia. So these 2 migratory bird species were found in this lake. And that was all about this Asian water bird census. Since it has not been completed yet, therefore the results regarding all of the wetlands are not available. Moving ahead, where is India's first open rock museum located? So here the right answer is option A. In Hyderabad, Telangana, this is located. Now, this museum displays around 35 different types of rocks which age from 3.3 billion years to 55 million years. So, this museum basically gives a glimpse of the Earth's history also. these rocks represent the deepest part of the earth, up to 175 kilometers from the surface of the earth. Okay, so this is how rich this museum is. The rocks have been sourced from Odisha, Tamil Nadu, Uttarakhand, Jharkhand, Jammu and Kashmir and others. So these are the places from where the rocks have been drawn for this museum. Okay. Now, while inaugurating this museum, the Union Minister of State for Science and Technology, Dr. Jitendra Singh, also released earthquake risk map of Lucknow and Dehradun. So this is an additional information, and I would say all these information that are mentioned here are additional information. Nobody is going to ask you about the years or the age of the rocks that are present in this museum. Nobody is going to ask you that. This is just for your information that this is seriously a very rich museum. It has a very good amount of rocks, first of all, and these rocks give a very deep knowledge regarding the origin of the earth and the deepest part of the earth. Moving ahead, the third question is, which ministry has launched the Veer Gatha project? So it is the project of Ministry of Education along with Ministry of Defense, the CBSE and My Government platform. So all of these have launched this Veer Gatha project in 2021. Right now the results of this project have been announced. So what this project is all about in reality, let's discuss that. So first of all, this Veer Gatha project is the project for the school children, okay, to make them aware about the gallantry award winners, about the great warriors of India, about the people who have fought for India's freedom and later on also who have protected India. Okay, so this project is all about that. Now this project involves children and encourages children to develop projects like develop assignments, write essays, etc., etc., on gallantry award winners. Okay, and this is for the students of class 3rd to 12th in all states and union territories, as well as schools affiliated to CBSE. And it is a part of the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. So, Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav is basically an entire year. Okay, and during this year, we have seen that numerous projects have been launched, and I know that majority of the projects you might not be able to remember that which projects have been launched. So here my advice would be that don't memorize it as the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav events. You need to take them individually, which event has been launched. For example, this Veer Gatha project, however it is a part of the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav, but still it has its own relevance. Similarly, the other events that have been conducted under the Veer Gatha project, particularly the schemes that have been launched, so you need to take them separately. You need to understand the project in itself, irrespective of it being a part of the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. Okay, Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav is basically an year, and in a year these projects are being launched. Okay, so that's how you can classify it easily and try to memorize it from the exam point of view. So recently 25 students of this project have been selected as the winners, and the dates were October 21 to November 21, 2021. So this was the month in which the Veer Gatha project was launched and continued, and during this tenure only these winners submitted their entries, and now the winners have been announced. So you don't have to memorize these dates. Remember that 2021 is the year of this, of the launch of this project. Okay. Next is, who heads the committee formed by the Ministry of Home Affairs to investigate the reasons for lapse in PM Modi's security in Punjab recently? So I hope that you are aware about what happened in Punjab very recently. Prime Minister was on his way to visit a memorial in Punjab, and there at a flyover he had to wait for 15 to 20 minutes, and that's the lapse that the ministry is talking about, for which the committee has been formed. So basically, this committee is a 3-member committee, okay? And the chairperson of this committee is Sudhir Kumar, okay? So, Sudhir Kumar Saxena is the full name, and he is the Secretary of Security in the Cabinet Secretariat. Do remember his entire designation, because designation itself is very important. Next is the other 2 members of the committee, Balbir Singh, who is the Joint Director of the Intelligence Bureau, and S. Suresh, who is IG of the SPG, the Special Protection Group. Okay, the reason I have already told you and what happened already we all know. Okay, so let's move ahead to the next question. Agriculture and Processed Food Products Export Development Authorities arm, VAEH, that is Varanasi Agri Export Hub, aims to promote the exports of dash region. So the right answer is Purvanchal region. So APIDA, which is an arm of the Ministry of Commerce, basically it has identified potential districts of Uttar Pradesh that will be promoted by the Varanasi Agri Export Hub. Okay, so this hub is basically, this hub has been created to promote the exports, agricultural goods exports from the Purvanchal region. And the districts that will be covered are these districts: Varanasi, Mirzapur, Azamgarh, Prayagraj, Gorakhpur, Basti, Ghazipur, Jaunpur, Chandoli and Sant Ravidas Nagar. So these are the districts. Moving ahead, what is the venue of the exercise Sea Dragon 2022? So here guys, the right answer is option B, Anderson Air Force Base. So the exercise Sea Dragon 2022 is a multilateral anti-submarine warfare. Okay, so far we have seen the naval exercises taking place between different countries. This is the submarine exercise, anti-submarine warfare. Okay, so that's the peculiarity of this exercise. Do remember that as well. Now, which nations are participating? US, India, Australia, Canada, Japan and South Korea. And I hope that you are clearly seeing that four out of these six nations are the Quad members. So this clearly helps you in memorizing the countries that have participated in the Sea Dragon exercise. India, US, Japan, Australia, this is the Quad grouping. And apart from these, the Canada and South Korea are the other two nations that have participated. Now, which country was leading it? So USA was leading it, and the 7th Fleet of USA's Navy participated in this exercise and led the other countries. Location is Anderson Air Force Base, which is located in Guam in the US territory in Micronesia. Okay, so do remember, it is located in Micronesia. Guam is the region, is the island on which this Air Force is located, because directly this can also become a question for you. So here guys, all the questions for today have ended, and this is the time for GK Factory. So here in this section, I have picked up some terms related to the market that I find have similarity, yet they are very, very different if you understand them in their meanings. Okay, so let's understand the terms. First term that I have taken up is initial public offer and the new fund offer. Okay, so these two terms are very basically, if you try to understand the inherent nature of these two terms, then they are very similar to the nature in terms of the function that they perform, but yet they are different. Now, how are they different? So as far as the IPO is concerned, IPO is issued by the company who is listed on any stock exchange in order to raise fund from the public and investors in general, in order to use that money for its expansion. Okay. On the other hand, new fund offer is like the initial public offer, but the difference is that it is issued by the mutual funds. So that's the basic difference between an IPO and a new fund offer. IPO is by the companies for their expansion. NFO is by mutual funds for further investing the money that they have gathered from the investors in a pool of securities like stocks and debts. So that's the guys, basic difference between IPO and FPO. So that was the first slide of two terms. In the next slide, I'm going to talk about the difference between mutual fund and the fund of funds. So mutual fund is basically a type of financial security, or the financial, basically an investment option where you pool your money, you give money to the fund manager, and then that fund manager uses your money to invest in a pool of securities like stock, debt, etc., etc., to diversify your risk, okay, to minimize your risk at the same time. And the mutual funds are also known as asset management company. Now, on the other hand, what is a fund of funds? So, basically, a fund of fund is, if you want to understand it in terms of mutual fund only, so it is basically a mutual fund that collects money from the investors but invest in another mutual fund. So, that's an interesting point here. A fund of funds is not investing directly in the stocks, directly in the bonds, no. It is investing in another mutual fund, which is the mutual fund, which is again investing in stocks and bonds. So that's the basic difference between fund of funds. Now, the fund of funds are not only restricted to mutual funds. We also have the AIF fund of funds also, the alternative investment fund of funds. So basically, in case of the AIF fund of funds, the AIF invest in the other AIFs. So the portfolio of the fund of funds is basically the it is contained of the portfolio of other mutual funds. Basically, it is comprised of the mutual funds or the AIFs, okay, whichever is the case you want to take. Next, and the last slide talks about the offer for sale and follow on public offer. What's the difference between them? So, in very basic terms, in very layman's term, if you understand the concept of offer for sale, then it is basically an invitation by the promoter to sell his or her own stake in the company. Whereas a follow-on public offer, which is also abbreviated as FPO, is the invitation by the company itself for inviting money from the public again. Okay, so once the company has issued its IPO, then only it issues its FPO again for asking the money from the public. So that was the difference between offer for sale and public follow-on public offer. So guys, here I hope that these terms are clear to you and this session is helpful for you. And if it is helpful for you, then do subscribe the channel, hit the bell notification, like this video, share it among your friends. Thank you so much for watching the session.